Good old church in here, y'all are so quiet. And they all said amen.
Let the church say amen.
All right. Welcome again to this meeting in the Orange County School Board. Thank you all for coming down here tonight. We have two very special folks who are going to lead us tonight in our moment of silence and our Pledge of Allegiance. And that is our Teacher of the Year, Mr. Kyle Denker from Timber Creek High School. And our Support Person of the Year, Ms. Christine Pretorius from Lake Sebilia Elementary. Please come on up to the lectern and lead us in a pledge in a moment of silence. If everybody could please stand.
Will you please stand and bow your heads for a moment of silence? Thank you.
And now for the pledge of the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, and liberty and justice for all. Thank you.
All right, well, don't sit down just yet, Ms. Pretorius and Mr. Denker. We're going to brag on y'all a moment. Stand up there at the lectern if you could. We want everybody to be able to see what wonderful Teacher of the Year we have this year and what wonderful Support Person of the Year. So as I mentioned, Mr. Denker is our 2019 Teacher of the Year. He is a computer science teacher at Timber Creek High School. And go Wolves. Before becoming a teacher, Mr. Denker was a software developer. Kudos to you, Mr. Denker. Thank you for coming into education. We need more men and women like you. His passions are rigorous and relevant courses for all and for exposing computer science to female students in particular and into changing the gender perception when it comes to computer science. And if you had been at our Teacher of the Year recognition dinner, Mr. Denker's video was truly inspiring. Not only is that his passion, but he has just made absolutely tremendous inroads in attracting young girls into computer science. So as a father of two daughters, Mr. Denker, thank you for that and kudos.
Thank you.
Our Support Person of the Year is no less impressive, Ms. Christina Pretorius. She was just named our 2018 Support Person of the Year. She is a paraprofessional in exceptional education at Lake Sebilia Elementary. She has worked at Lake Sebilia for 13 years, but has actually been a part of that school community for 19 years. She works closely with our reigning Teacher of the Year, Chris Arendt. Is Ms. Arendt here? I have a feeling she probably is. And Chris, good seeing you. Reigning Teacher of the Year at Lake Sebilia. She works directly with pre-K students in the Deaf and Hard of Hearing program. She also serves the school on multiple committees and gets to know all of the students to support them academically and emotionally. And again, if you had been at our Support Person of the Year, her video, and I'm not being dramatic, it's going to sound like I am, literally brought tears to my eyes, I think all of us. It was a very moving video because her passion, her love of her students comes through clearly. And I can never say this at the dinner, Ms. Pretorius, but Dr. Jenkins and I and some of the other board members, we have a little game we play sometimes because we truly don't know who's going to win. And more often than not, we're wrong. But this year I was positive after watching your video, and I nailed it, Dr. Jenkins. She was a winner, and it was well-deserved, as were all our nominees, but yours was incredibly inspiring. So, folks, give it up for Ms. Christina Pretorius. We also have a very special recognition tonight as well, a partner of ours, and it's a good segue right here because when we hold our Support Person of the Year dinner and when we hold our Teacher of the Year dinner and a host of other events that we hold throughout the year, whether it's State of the Schools, whether it's our special recognition events, we're proud at the school board, but we really, it's false pride. We have no reason to be proud of this because it's not due to us, that we don't spend 1 cent of taxpayer dollars on those events. But we have a partner who's with us tonight who always steps up to the plate and sponsors those dinners. And when we do those recognition events, just to give those of you in the audience who may have never been to one, Our Teacher of the Year event is attended by over 700 attendees. Our Support Person of the Year is attended by over 700 employees. If you've ever just put on a wedding reception for 50 people, you know how expensive that is. You can imagine what it is to feed 700 plus. And that partner is the CFE Federal Credit Union, and their representatives are here tonight. Not only do they sponsor everything for us, but they also sponsor a program called My CFE for Schools Debit Card Program. And through this program, CFE donates 3 cents to the district every time a My CFE for Schools Affinity Debit Card is used. So we'd like to welcome up to the podium the president and the CEO of CFE Federal Credit Union, Mr. Kevin Miller, to make some comments. Mr. Miller, welcome and thank you.
Thank you. It's truly our privilege and honor to continue our longstanding partnership with Orange County Public Schools. It's a fantastic partnership. As you know, we were founded by teachers 80 years ago, and we've kept our partnership very active and alive, and that's our intention going forward. We've continued to find ways to expand our partnership. We've got a new high school branch going in another Orange County school this year into Ocoee for next year. But we have a special program where when you use a debit card, as you said, a donation is given. And this year, we were donating $47,500 to Orange County Public Schools. Our total donation since we started this program is $447,900. And we'd love to present you with a check. I have my staff with me. I have Cassie Roach, Miriam Mitchell, and Lynn Dang are with me. And we'd love to present you guys with the check.
All right. Thank you. The board members, we're going to filter down in front of the dais and take a quick photo.
All right, we have two more recognitions tonight, and this is the time of year that our board members love because we really do get to recognize excellence in our schools and our employees and our team. And tonight we recognize two teams of staff members who are outstanding in their area of expertise and have recently been recognized at the national and the state level. Our first group is our Curriculum, Instruction, and Digital Learning group. And could we have everyone from Curriculum, Instruction, and Digital Learning please stand and remain standing for a moment. Ladies and gentlemen, this team has been nationally recognized as the 2017 Digital Superhero Award recipients. That's the coolest name for an award I've ever heard. Digital superheroes.
The award was presented by the Learning Council, and the Learning Council is a national research institute focused on providing context for the shift in education to digital curriculum. The selection was based on the district's vision and leadership within the LaunchED Digital Learning Program. For our attendees, viewers, and listeners online who may not be familiar with LaunchED or LaunchED, it is an immersive and interactive learning experience that combines technology, digital content, and instruction to strengthen a student's learning experience. Congratulations to this entire team. In fact, you should know this entire team also just presented to over 250 educators from around not just the state or country, but around the actual globe during the Future of Education Technology Conference at the Orange County Convention Center. And I understand that they were a huge hit, as I'm not surprised, because we've seen them present before and they're always a hit with us. We could not be more proud of y'all, and hundreds of convention goers, I understand, were just incredibly impressed by OCPS, and we are leaders in this field, and we are leaders in this field because of your expertise, your commitment, and your passion for our children. So on behalf of the board, congratulations and thank you very much. Now we're going to watch a video that talks a little bit about their good work. Ms. Babinski.
Ellison has more on how Orange County is showcasing its efforts to national leaders in education in tonight's Getting Results in Our Schools.
Getting Results in Our Schools, sponsored by Crayola Experience.
Education and technology leaders gathered in Orlando for the Future of Educational Technology Conference, and Millennia Elementary and Southwest Middle Schools opened their doors to conference goers to show off how digital learning is getting results in the Orange County School District.
So how would this
work? Our test scores are solid, and we keep going up every year.
Millennia Elementary School is a pilot digital learning school in the OCPS Launch Ed program, an ideal place to show attendees at the Future of Educational Technology Conference how digital learning is working for teachers and students. Launch Ed uses technology, digital content, and instruction to strengthen the students' learning experience with immersive and interactive lessons.
You have to be on it and with them and be open to learning new things, but also be ready to challenge those students that have learned PowerPoint in a 30-minute lesson that are ready to excel and then add in more to that.
OCPS was the first district in Central Florida to provide a digital device to every incoming high school student, and the program has continually expanded to train teachers and reach students at every grade level.
Technology is something our children need to be exposed to, and in some communities it's harder to have a computer in the home, so as a school, we need to provide that for them so that they're ready for the future.
With more than 100,000 digital devices distributed to students, Orange County Public Schools is a national leader in digital learning. And as the district further develops its digital curriculum, it hopes convention visitors could be inspired to implement similar programs in their schools.
We are integrating technology. We're integrating it in a great way that helps students to help them accomplish the standards. But at the same time, we've never lost focus that this is about teaching and learning.
I'm so excited to be able to take some things back to my school and to our district.
OCPS is aiming for 1-to-1 by 2021. That's one digital device per student in every school by 2021. I'm Bridget Ellison. I'll see you in the morning.
So in that video, the principal that was featured, she may look familiar if you're sitting near the front of the room, was our 2017 and 18 Innovative Principal of the Year, Ann Lionel. Ms. Lionel, please stand and let's recognize you. Ms. Lina is one of our master principals. She is over at Millennia Gardens Elementary Schools. She actually has two schools under her wing, which is what a master principal does, just shows how special she is. We want to congratulate you, Ms. Lina, on your award from the Florida Council of Instructional Technology Leaders. The award is well-deserved, and we're just so proud of the work you do on behalf of our students as well. So, folks, again, join me in recognizing Ms. Ann Lina, our employee. We have, Ms. Cato, let me go to you at this point before I go to our next recognition.
Well, you know, earlier we heard some teachers talk to us about how they would go to conferences and come back and say, well, we're already doing that. And as you know, as a board member, we learn a lot when we go to the Council of Great City Schools. And when we were starting on this journey, and Mr. Bixler is smiling, because they did a presentation of what we were looking at doing. And if my memory is correct, Houston and Miami were the other two presenters. And so these three teams thought, okay, we're going to get together and we're going to share best practices. So I ended up going to all these different sessions that were on digital. And I would go some places and they had no plan. They were just going to give them to them and the children were going to figure it out. And I kept going, I don't know how this is going to work. And, I'd like to know what some of those districts are doing now, because I was like, we had a plan, and I am so proud of what we have done. We had a vision. We knew it was the right thing to do. We knew that we had to figure out what platform. We knew we needed to figure out what device. Would this work? Would that work? Can you download and update all those computers at once, or do you have to do it individually? And so I am so proud of the grit that you all have shown to not give up on it, to do what we know is right for children. And our children who are coming into school, and my son's going to kill me, but my grandson has started playing with a computer that I gave him. He's in VPK. And his mom was talking to me, and I said, now that he's figuring out that computer, and she's surprised how fast he's figured it out, and she's put educational software on it, I looked at her and I said, you can't hold him back, because he's going to be bored. Because he's figuring this stuff out and he's having these conversations, these higher level conversations that honestly, I don't think my children had them until third or fourth grade, but I'm talking to a 5-year-old in the back of my car talking to me about Groundhog Day. And I think, the computer and the internet and all of those resources. So I am so proud of each and every one of you and the superintendent and Dr. Jara and all the teaching and learning people. I'm just proud to say Orange County Public Schools and the voters to give us the money to be able to do the computers. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Ms. Cadle. Mrs. Robinson.
I don't have to add much to that other than congratulations, but I do want to point out, too, that we have amazing partners. We got the news release just this last week where we're getting 700 hotspots from Sprint to be given to some of our students that need it, because not all families have Wi-Fi at home or have internet access. So, and I know that's just one example of partnerships. I'm sure there's been many examples of partnerships doing internet access and other things for our students. So I just want to point out that really is it's our wonderful department, but it's them seeking out support from partners. So thank you so much for always looking for those opportunities too.
Mrs. Gordon.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm going to back this train up. Okay. The reason why I'm backing it up, because it's a poor frog that does not praise his own pond, baby. And I'm going to praise my teachers tonight, okay? Because this is one of my favorite, and they know it. I would like Diane Gullett to stand. Would she please stand? She is our area superintendent for the digital schools, okay? But the person that I just love dearly, remain standing, because you have, okay? Because Daryl Friend, all of us have a dream on the board, and practically every one of our dreams, it's alive and well and blooming. And I remember Dr. Jenkins calling us in, asking us which school in your district. We've selected this one, and we've selected, no, wait a minute, whoa, I got to get the best of the best right now that I know that's going to carry this thing on. Plus, we don't want this school to die out because it was one of our newest schools. But Diane Gullett helped to carry the gauntlet on with this person. But this is an amazing person. that have been in my life a long time. And that's none other than Ann Lynham. Ann, will you please stand? Master Principal, I have to thank Dr. Jim. Please, let's give her a hand, because you all really don't know her. You really don't know. She has two, remain standing, Ann, two. You two, Diane, just hold her up, because, all right, I'm just taking this point of personal privilege, baby. And the reason why I'm bragging on her, because when Dr. Jenkins brought the idea to us, and Darrell Flynn was one of the pushers and the chairman, and it, everybody had their little baby. You know, mine was a DSAG and all that. Joey had one. Darrell was the little pusher behind it, and then she said, let's see if we could get it in the, oh, yeah, let's see if we could get it in the schools. She doesn't boast about it, but I boast for her. And I went back to Dr. Jenkins. I said, I need a favor. And she said, well, I said, I need you to give it to Millennium. When I, you know what? Every teacher over there was overworked, like these teachers came in today. Every single one of them, this was a multitude of things. I wrote down several of the things the lady said. Just one more thing, and you're not going to get any pay. So, Wendy, this is what happened at Millennium. Everybody that we asked, would they consider thinking about it? When I told Ann Lynham this, it was never a no. They not only went beyond the realm of what they were supposed to do, look where we ended up. She ended up as the STEM Principal of the Year. I'm just amazed. And not only that, her hardworking faculty. I go there late at night, early in the morning. None of these people are paid. So, Dr. Jenkins, we really got to go back. I think we heard the teachers loud and clear, and this button speaks louder than I think it does. You know, you can't put the students first if you put teachers last. And we would never, ever think of putting those teachers at any of our over 200 schools last. But I want you to know, we would never want to do that. And we know that the kids can't be first unless the teachers are committed to us. That every teacher at Millennium Elementary School was committed. And then when we had to get our sister school, every parent came in. They were in there working with all that new equipment and really making a. And I wanted you and Dr. Gollett to be recognized today because of your leadership, taking on the task that Dr. Jenkins and Dr. Jarrell and the staff put upon you. That was a lot of work because you guys were the first ones in that little rollout. Joey had her school, Darrell had a school, Nancy had a school, but you all exceeded yourself. And I'm telling you, we will go back to the table and we will look at things that will make the teachers proud. We may have to go back to what we did with the comp times and creative times. And I know you do all of that over there. And I always tell you, I have the best teacher in Osceola County to work for. I mean, I love where I work. I love what I do because I have a great principal and a great staff that we get to be free. They know when we are worn out and tired, she'll say, go home. Get off, I'm locking the door, get out of here. And it may that we may need to do a little bit more of kindness because what I heard today was bullying, but I've never seen you bully your staff. I've never seen you talk down to your staff, and I've never had to report you to Dr. Jenkins. I love you both. Give her a hug for me, Dr. Gollett.
Ms. Flynn. All right, we do have one more recognition tonight. Ms. Golan and Ms. Lina, we're buying you a cup of coffee afterwards just for having to stand that long. If this wasn't a public meeting, we'd buy you something else, but we'll give you a cup of coffee. Also tonight, we have one final recognition. Tonight, another department that was recently recognized and awarded by the state of Florida in recognition of their excellence is our OCPS surplus team. Could we have everybody from our surplus operations department please stand and allow us to recognize you? This team of outstanding individuals and those who work with them who are not here tonight have been awarded by the Florida Department of Environmental Protection with a recycling recognition award. The team, with the help of social media, specifically Facebook, has been able to increase awareness within schools about surplus operations within our district. Surplus increased their Facebook followers to over 1,000 after its marketing efforts, and it continues to grow daily. In the past, Surplus was only reaching 200 bookkeepers, but now they are reaching beyond bookkeepers and connecting with our classroom professionals, our teachers, and our district staff. The impact to the district and cost avoidance by reusing Surplus materials has exceeded all goals and objectives, and with the help of social media, the Surplus department ended fiscal 17 with a $2.4 million savings to the taxpayers of Orange County, Florida. That deserves recognition and applause. We would like to thank this entire team on their hard work and successful efforts. And, you know, the fact that this award comes from the Florida Department of Environmental Protection is very important to this board. This board made a real push 3-4 years ago under the leadership of multiple board members to make our schools greener, both through our recycling programs and our conservation programs, and we've made great strides, and y'all are a big part of that effort, as are our principals and our teachers and our entire support personnel down at the classroom level. So thank you for making us so proud and making us look so good. Thank you. Ms. Flynn.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You know, incredible. We've sort of, the recognition sort of go the gambit to the Surplus team. Great work. I mean, it shows the multiple layers that we have to really have a well-run school district. To the Teacher of the Year and the Support Person of the Year, congratulations. Go Wolves. Mr. Denkirk, yes, that I know. Just like Ms. Petronius, is that Petroian? Very, very hard workers, like all of our employees. Kyle is unique in that he does have a mission to bring computer and coding to every student. And I think if you let him, he would bring it to every school in the district. In fact, I think that's the mission that you gave for yourself at the Teacher of the Year. So, so proud of you. Thank you. And is Dr. Paduano, the principal, is she still in the room? Oh, she's way back there. Thank you. You know, what do they say? The pace of the pack is determined by the pace of the leader. So, Dr. Paduano, thank you for being so supportive of your teachers who want to go that extra mile. So, congratulations on that. In regard, and I have two more. To CFE, you guys are so amazing. We have the student bank, student-led banks in District 2 and 2 schools. What a gift to our students to be able to have that experience, that real world experience of working in a bank. And so the students appreciate it, and I really appreciate it. Thank you very much for that. And I know it's in Boone, and it will be in Ocoee, correct? And, oh, Oak Ridge. Oak Ridge. So, wow, thank you so much. And there's, if you've never been to a student bank on campus, you need to go. It's incredible. I mean, it's a bank.
And they get hired
afterwards. But it's an enormous amount of effort and resources that have to go into putting that together. So I appreciate it. Thank you so much. In regard to the digital team, thank you. And thank you, Ms. Gordon, for that plug. But it was a push of mine. And I thank you for doing it and the way you're doing it. You can see, you know, there's art in there and there's, you know, but the work isn't done. And that's what I want to make sure everybody knows. Their work isn't done. They continue to work. I mean, there's more parent education that needs to be given. There's more of the actual technical part of, you know, building those firewalls. It's an evolving initiative that still is taking a lot of brain power to put it together. And so for that, I thank you, because they're not willing just to say, okay, we did it. You know, and like Mrs. Cato said, it's not just here's a computer. It's so much involved with curriculum, with security, with the digital, technical, electronic, you know, all of that. And so it's a massive effort. I'm proud to be in a school district that's putting it forward the way we are. So I wanted to thank you for that and thank everybody at this board and the superintendent. So that's my, did I leave out any of the recognition people?
I think. The surplus is the one.
Surplus, I got the surplus.
I know, but the report is so much better.
Yes, and I'll let you. That was Mrs., when I first got on the board, I think that was one of Mrs. Gordon's, when it came to surplus, woo, we all sort of like, you know, held on to our keys and wigs and everything. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you for that.
All right, terrific. I have a new phrase, keys and wigs. I've never heard that one. It's going to make it into my lexicon. Dr. Jenkins, do we have any administrators to recognize tonight before I pause?
We do not, Chairman, but I do know there was a small contingency back there from Brookshire that wanted to make sure that the new principal, Jason Fritz, was on the agenda for a transfer. He is not here because he's not a new appointment, but they wanted to make sure their new principal was going to be arriving. So I'm reassuring them of that. There are no appointments to be recognized, Chairman.
Well, congratulations to our curriculum instruction and digital learning team, to our surplus team as well, and to Mr. Danker and Ms. Pretorius. And at this point, we're going to pause. I know the board would like to shake all of our honorees' hands. And then afterwards, y'all can stay and watch a sausage be made if you'd like, or you can filter on out and go grab yourself some ice cream or a beverage of your choice.
They saw all of us at Greg's meeting. We're pretty sure the way they do it is they run our license plates on our cars. And then they were knocking on our doors in May when it happened, asking us for a comment. And I was like, and like they rang my doorbell, and we didn't answer the door. I texted everyone else, and I was like,
yeah, be aware.
Okay, we are going to go ahead and move forward with our regularly scheduled meeting this time. Let me make a preliminary announcement. Any individual who would like to address an item on our consent or our non-consent agenda may do so by completing a yellow speaker card. Such as this, you can obtain a yellow speaker card from Ms. McGill at the far left-hand side of the dais. When that agenda item comes up before us, I will call on you to speak, and at that time, you will have 3 minutes to address the board. We do have, if anybody's here for it, I'll make the announcement twice, but when we get to item 3.01, that is a public hearing on the approval of our adopted instructional materials. So if anybody here is to speak on that, please sign up as well. Dr. Jenkins, do we have any changes to our agenda?
Only one change, Chairman. I made during pre-agenda an additional change that will not take place, so only a single change to your agenda. That is item 1701. Subject change from request approval of the School Board of Orange County, Florida to rename Audubon Park Elementary School to Baldwin Park Elementary School is being changed to approval of the School Board of Orange County, Florida to select a name for the relief school located at 1750 Commonway Road, Orlando, Florida 32814. The additional item that I had given you before will remain on the matrix.
All right. Well, when we get there, congratulations. Y'all got your name back. I know that community is very excited about that. All right. So, board members, I find cause to amend the agenda as suggested by Dr. Jenkins. Can I entertain a motion to do so?
So moved.
It's been moved by Vice Chair Kober. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Ms. Cadle and Mrs. Gordon. Is there any debate or discussion of that motion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Show the agenda adopted. All right. Board members, we are now on agenda item 3.01. Dr. Jenkins.
Thank you, Chairman. This is the time of year where we have a public hearing prior to the approval of your adopted instructional materials. All of those materials have been posted and advertised as required and previously provided to the board. If there are any questions, Dr. Vasquez or her team are happy to entertain them.
Let me announce again, is there anybody tonight who has come to provide us with public testimony on our adoption of the instructional materials as reflected in agenda item 3.01? Seeing none. Let me also explain, I always feel compelled to do this to the members of our audience. By the time it gets to this point to us at a meeting, we have all been thoroughly briefed on it, and we adopt every year our instructional materials as a requirement of Florida law. So if you don't hear a lot of discussion, that's why. So at this point, can I entertain, is there any debate or discussion, board members, on the proposed resolution? Seeing none, can I entertain a motion to approve the
Second. Materials?
It's been moved by Ms. Flynn, it's been seconded by Ms. Gordon that we approve agenda item 3.01. Is there any further debate or discussion on that matter? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, nay. Show the motion adopted unanimously. We are now on our consent agenda. We do have two speakers on consent agenda item 4.01. First is Ms. Cindy Hamilton, and next, Ms. Jessica Torrance. Ms. Hamilton, welcome.
No, I just find this process very amusing, actually. So. Digital education is a business. Children are the mechanisms through which the economic value is extracted. Eric Schmidt who is a former board chair of Google's parent company, Alphabet, said that data is the new oil. The plan is to frack data from public school students, many who live in poverty. It is a profit-taking enterprise that unites venture capital, higher education, and philanthropy. OCPS has pushed our schools toward automated education over and above the mandates coming from Tallahassee. No one consulted parents. We were not given the option to choose between teachers and online test prep because the district officials knew that we would tell them that virtual courses and adaptive software are no substitute for face-to-face instruction of real teachers. Data dashboards cannot replace the nuanced assessment that human teachers provide, even as artificial intelligence learning assistants are breathlessly promoted. Parents know that it is teachers who change the children's lives, not computer code. iReady and other ed tech will not empower our children. Instead, they restrict learning to limit pathways using data mining. Learning online is learning that is constantly monitored and surveilled. With a learning management system, the algorithm is in charge, not the teacher. In an era of leaks and security breaches, nothing about our children that is uploaded to the cloud can ever be secure. We know data is used to profile, algorithms are racially biased, and classroom devices collect vast amounts of personally identifiable information. Health concerns arise with increased screen time, especially for our youngest. These include vision impairment, concentration and behavioral problems, and Wi-Fi exposure. Plugged-in kids can become isolated, disconnected, and destabilized. Digital products are harming kids in their own schools, places that they should feel safe. When bridging the digital divide means hooking kids up to corporate learning modules, it's a bridge too far. Parents want money in schools to reduce class size, restore librarians. What would we do with all this money being spent on ed tech? We would make sure every child had access to school plays, choir, foreign language instruction, sports debate teams, field trips before putting a dime into virtual classes. We want public funds spent on bringing joy back to schools, and we want public funds to support teachers and not ed tech. Parents don't want data-driven education. We don't want our kids treated as human capital. Our schools are not profit centers for predatory social impact data mining ventures. The interests of schools, teachers, and parents must take precedence over for-profit interests as well as those of their nonprofit partners. Local control of Orlando's schools means nothing if corporations control our classrooms through contracted ed tech vendors. The voice of the people must come first. Please follow wrenchinthegears.com. And I'm going to tell you, after the presentation you just had, I feel like we are in the twilight zone and that maybe teachers were not heard when they came earlier.
Give us your address for the record, Ms. Hamilton.
4199 Tomasa Court, Orlando, 32812.
All right. Thank you. Our next speaker is Ms. Jessica Torrance. Ms. Torrance, welcome. If you could start with your address, ma'am.
Hi. Thank you. Yes. My name is Jessica Torrance. I live at 11316 Ashboro Drive, Orlando, Florida, 32837. And I feel that, I didn't prepare a formal thing for this situation. I'm definitely reacting as a parent with a child in first grade. So I feel that after the presentations tonight and after the recognition of the team, who I would never say that people don't come in and work hard, but I can say that the road to hell is paved with good intentions. And it sounds like there's a lot of good intention, but that road's not headed anywhere good. The children, when they walk into a classroom, they need the interaction and the education from a human. That's really what it is. And it's because I'll get a little personal, it's because when my six-year-old walks in and is given an essay topic to talk about, and it causes him to have a meltdown, because he has anxiety issues and depression and other undiagnosed situations, a computer wouldn't even know that. A computer would only have the prompt in front of it and would do no more than that. But the teacher stepped up and saw those tears falling and took my son and gave him a blanket and sat him down and hugged him. And a computer can't do that. And that's not to say that technology isn't important to students, that we don't need to give them the access to what the future will be. But it is to say that to say a computer is going to teach or instruct our children is taking away the most vital thing for them, which is the heart of a teacher. So I'm going to say that I, you know, with the teachers who came here tonight, and I support them not only as a parent but a teacher in Osceola County, I'm going to say that it's almost an insult that we would have a day dedicated to zeros and ones and cold programs that can't do anything for our students other than make them data points and maybe match their data depending on what they clicked properly or not that day, right? That's an insult to the teachers. And until we have a day dedicated to each teacher in OCPS that shows up in the morning, leaves their family, stays late, then this is just nothing more than an insult. So I would say instead, you should remember that teaching is about connections. Teaching is tangible. Teaching is human. Computer programs are not. Thank you. Thank you for tonight.
Thank you, Ms. Torrance. Our next speaker is Eric Schwalbach. Mr. Schwalbach, welcome.
Don't start that yet. 874 Bending Oak Trail, Winter Garden, Florida. I didn't plan to talk tonight, but I'm at a school that's digital curriculum middle school for 3 years. I can tell you what I see. It's not great. If digital curriculum was solving our problems, our high school algebra scores wouldn't be below the district average. They wouldn't. The high school, you know, Ocoee High School's had computers for a long time. The scores would be higher than everybody else. I'm not saying that because scores are important, because they're not. We need to teach kids how to ask questions, not answer questions, okay? The Wright brothers, Ford, all of the imagination people that created our country were taught to dream and to think, not sit on a computer and answer questions. Apps apps are created to circumvent what you're trying to get kids to do. Kids are trying to find the easiest way to do things, and an app is to make things easier for you. Steve Jobs, Bill Gates, they created a computer to not do meaningless tasks. And what we're doing is we're creating them to do that. Now, iReady. Start with this. Kids take an iReady score. Their scores are awful when they start. First year at the school I was at, awful. They don't even try. They don't even care. So iReady produces them this curriculum. They're doing second and third grade stuff. Not rigor. Not Common Core. They're doing third and second grade stuff. They didn't try on the test. So then I bribe them and say, look, I'm going to give you pizza. I'm going to give you this. Our school says, hey, we're going to do a Go Green event. And the scores go up. Was it because of iReady? No. It was because somebody bribed them to try on a test. Okay. I can tell you, I use Land School and I watch what they're doing on iReady. There's not deep inner thought. You know what I mean? At the end of the day, we need kids to ask great questions, not answer questions. You know, what are we doing to promote creativity? America's great because we're better than China, we're better than Japan, we're better than all those countries because we have great thinkers, we have ingenuity, we have creativeness. Are we killing the creativeness by just teaching to a test? Springboard. Springboard doesn't let kids read books. You're supposed to, when we were growing up, you read books because you wanted to be an astronaut, you wanted to be a cowboy, you wanted to fall in love with the cute guy with the love story. You know what I mean? We've gotten away from that. If kids aren't reading stuff they love and all they're doing is reading informational text. I mean, how many of you guys read stuff you don't want to read? You know what I mean? Think about it. The last book you just read, you know, did you enjoy it? Well, probably not if it was something you had to do for your job. But how many books did you pick up and read or you love? And that's the thing is let's get back to the love of reading. And I'm not saying there's great programs. I use IXL all the time. It made my kids double, triple growth. But I'm teaching the material. All IXL is doing is grading it for them and giving them feedback. They love IXL, which I don't understand because it's work. It's work, 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 work. And they hate iReady because it's cartoonish. And I'm just giving you real feedback. And if you want to talk to my kids, I'll give them 30 minutes to all type, hey, how do you feel about this? How do you feel about this? And then you can hear from them, not me. So thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Schwalbach. All right. I don't believe, do we have any other speakers on the consent agenda? Okay. So I'm board members, I punched my button, and I'm going to say a few words because I think they need to be said. First of all this proclamation does, and I'm going to go ahead and read it into the record. It doesn't say that a computer should ever take the place of a teacher. It doesn't say that technology should ever take the place of a teacher. What it says, just go to the written word, whereas Digital Learning Day is an annual national and international celebration of great teaching and learning in K-12 schools and showcases innovative teachers, leaders, and digital learning programs using technology to transform education and improve student outcomes. Whereas since Digital Learning Day's inception, thousands of teachers and schools across the country and around the world have held local activities supporting the event. Whereas digital learning offers new and exciting ways for students to learn daily. Whereas digital learning and the effective use of technology can assist every teacher by providing real-time information to track individual student progress, provide new and creative learning processes that put student needs and interests at the center of learning, create improved and efficient learning processes, giving teachers more flexibility and time to spend with each student, reduce administrative obligations that take time away from teaching, and whereas education has yet to realize the potential of effective use of technology in delivering personalized learning to every child for the purpose of improving student achievement, whereas Digital Learning Day provides each teacher, student, parent, and school with the opportunity to learn how to use technology in combination with great teaching to modernize, personalize, and improve learning, whereas Digital Learning Day provides an opportunity for the U.S. education system to embrace the effective use of technology in a positive and transformative manner, as have most successful industries and businesses across the nation and world, whereas today's world demands the nation have a highly trained workforce skilled in the use of technology and digital content in order to compete in the global economy, and whereas it is important that any change in learning methods and infusion of technology in schools be done in a high quality manner that best helps every student and ensures the appropriate spending of public funds, and whereas the 7th Annual National Digital Learning Day will serve to educate teachers, students, schools, parents, policymakers, and the public on ways to integrate high-quality digital learning and the effective use of technology to improve the learning of every student. Now, therefore, be it resolved that Orange County Public Schools does hereby recognize February 22, 2018 as Digital Learning Day. Nowhere in that resolution does it say technology should replace the teacher. And it's a little bit ironic that I'm defending this because I'm well known on my board as a lover of books, someone who has a library still filled with hardcovers. I drive my wife nuts because I won't buy paper covers, I only buy hardcovers. That's how much I love books. Someone who still insists, to the chagrin of some board members, on getting my documents in paper still. But all that being said, I also have three children who are 15, 16, and 19. I also own a business and am an employer. And I also work with high poverty populations, and I have also come to the realization unless we raise a generation of digital natives, those without access to technology are going to be left behind and left on the dust heap of history. And it's that simple. When I go to hire, all applications nowadays come in through computers. What is very sad to me as someone who works with high poverty populations is oftentimes they struggle to find jobs. And it's because almost every job today is posted online and one has to apply online, and that's a foreign skill to many high poverty populations. I am extremely proud of the fact that we have rolled out a one-to-one digital technology initiative because it means that every child, regardless of the zip code they live in, has access to technology and can be conversant in technology. My kids don't need that. Frankly, 98% of you in this room, your kids don't need that because you have resources. But we're a public school system with 207,000 students. And this may shock you, I would venture a guess, a good 50 to 60,000 of the kids do not have access to that technology. They wouldn't have laptops if it weren't for OCPS. They wouldn't have access to Wi-Fi. They wouldn't be able to compete at a college level or a post-secondary career technical education level if they didn't have access to that technology that we're providing them access to. And for that, I'm very, very proud of this district and the way we've rolled it out. What's a little bit frustrating as well with some of the speakers we've heard from is The fact that we offer digital learning and digital curriculum, well, it's something I'm very, very proud of. And the fact that we require every student to take at least one digital course is something completely beyond the ken of our control, because we have no say over that at the local school level. That is a state statute that has required us to convert all our instructional materials to digital instruction, with the state's goal of having 100% of all instructional materials being digital within the next decade. And by the way, it's not just a state statute. It is a federal mandate, unless you want to forego federal dollars. And what's frustrating about the speakers is the speakers who have spoken to us, many of them tonight, are incredibly well-versed in these topics and intelligent, and they know that. So to criticize OCPS and this school board for somehow trying to foist technology on folks as if it's an unwanted mandate from the board is completely unfair, and frankly something that I abhor, which is intellectually dishonest. Because it's one thing to say something you're ignorant of, it's another to say something you know better of and to try to make it into a political football or political issue. This board also was criticized roundly tonight for not imposing local control. This board actually is suing the state legislature right now over the issue of local control. And I can tell you, for these board members up here, who is one of 12 school districts in the entire state of Florida that has sued the Florida legislature and the State Department of Education and the Florida governor over taking away local control, it was especially galling and appalling to hear us get criticized over not fighting for local control. Actions speak far louder than empty rhetoric. And our actions have spoken loudly, not just through this lawsuit that we filed, but through our actions for the last 7-8 years, where we have routinely lobbied every state legislator locally in their offices, routinely gone to Tallahassee, weighed in through resolutions and proclamations, and have really, frankly, put our policies where our mouth is and not just spoken the talk, but walked the walk. And frankly, I'm leaving this board, but there are a number of board members up here who have giant targets on their back from the charter school industry, which is a deep-pocketed, powerful industry, over the very fact that we're one of only 12 districts and the largest district in the state of Florida suing that industry to fight for local control of our schools. So I think these board members, you know, I don't think any of us deserve a pat on the back, because we're just doing our job. And I always tell folks when they thank me, we're not looking for a pat on the back, we're just doing our jobs. But it does need to be said that we are fighting for local control. As far as recognizing teachers, that I think is especially galling. We just recognize the Teacher of the Year. We recognize every year Teachers of the Year at all 192 of our schools. We recognize, I can't think of a single meeting in my 8 years on this school board where we have not recognized a teacher or a group of teachers. Literally, I don't think we've ever had a school board meeting where we have not recognized teachers. So again, not only do we recognize them in that fashion, but this board has fought mightily to increase pay. We have taken on the legislature over the lack of funding for teacher pay. We have gone to the voters not once, not twice, not three times, but four times, asking the voters of this county to pass taxes to support school construction so teachers and students and families have high quality, safe, secure facilities to go to school in, and also to support an additional local option, one meal, which most counties in the state, in fact, virtually all of them, don't have, so we can provide higher raises and pay raises for our teachers, because our number one priority is teacher pay, and we all believe fervently that our teachers are underpaid. And even in the height of the recession, when other school districts were cutting pay, cutting teachers, we made sure that we still put some extra dollars in our teachers' pocket and made sure that we didn't fire a single teacher. And the last thing I'll say, and you can tell I'm a little fired up about this after the earlier meeting, but those who get up, and especially those who know better, and criticize this board for things like testing mandates and classroom observations, when they know full well that that is state statute and that we are required to administer the test, and we have dramatically scaled back and eliminated almost every local option test we can, I think that's particularly galling, especially we've been the tip of the spear and fighting over testing mandates from Tallahassee and from the federal government. So thank you for members allowing me to express my opinions. I know I probably speak for a number of you. I think one thing that I find very, very sad in public discourse today is we seem to have lost the ability to disagree and respectfully just agree to disagree. Nowadays, we've become a society where, and this isn't fair, because we had a good 13 or 14 speakers earlier, and I think all 12 or 13 of them were very respectful. But I think sometimes we've gone to a point where anybody who disagrees with us is just in the eyes of some, the comments and the way they're delivered, either an idiot or a bumbling idiot or doesn't know what they're talking about, when frankly, sometimes folks just disagree with you. And that's okay. It's not okay if it's not an informed disagreement, but it's okay sometimes to just disagree with somebody. So thank you, board members. Ms. Flynn.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I want to clap for you. Mine's not going to be maybe as eloquent, but I did want to comment. I am a huge proponent of this technical digital initiative. I'll stand right here and say I would hope that whoever gets in this board would not be so short-sighted as to ratchet it back, limit it what our improvements have done. We use a blended model. The teacher is the most important element in that classroom. There is face-to-face dialogue and contact with the teachers. I go in the classrooms, and I know they're going to say, oh, there's code words for you when you come in. Oh, they're only showing you. I see the classrooms just like everyone else does. The teacher is the central figure in that room. Just as we needed improvement when we worked with books, this is an evolution of a program that we're offering. There's always going to be room for improvement. It's not done yet. And just today, I coordinated a meeting with a middle school teacher who's frustrated about some elements of the digital program, and I put them together with the digital district department and through Dr. Vasquez. I went through the proper protocol, and they're meeting with him because I do think we need that feedback. We have to have the feedback from the parents, from the students, and from the teachers. That's vital so that we can grow the program. But have you met any kids that don't like it? And I will say, at the Parent Academy, a parent told me I don't like it. Her child stood right next to her and said, I love it. I can keep my homework. So we talked to Dr. Jara. I put her in touch. And there is more information that needs to come out to parents. It's not a perfect system, but it's innovative. We can't go back on our kids. Look how much technology we use at our age. Our kids are digital native. So I thank you, Mr. Chair. I think you were very eloquent. I think it's what's insulting is for people to think that we don't think teachers are important, that we don't think that we don't care, that we don't think our curriculum's out before we put them. I think that's really insulting. And so we're trying our best. I'm not running again. So I hope whoever's in my seat will not turn back the hands of time.
Mrs. Robinson.
I wanted to say a couple things. One, I want to point out, I went to Winter Park High School this morning and was an event in their media center. And one thing that was really refreshing and exciting, and their media specialist was very excited about it, is now that they are digital one-to-one, they don't have to have the computer labs in the media center anymore. And her media center was phenomenal. It had chess tables set up with chess boards that she said the kids love to come in and play chess. There was an area where there was an ongoing puzzle, so you know you could come in and sit down on a jigsaw puzzle. And there was a whole area with plants and some hydroponic plantings and stuff, and there were fish and Legos. There were all kinds of things that she said she didn't have room for when she had her computer lab in there. So the fact that the students are one-to-one, she's very excited to have her media center back. So that's one example that I saw today. I do believe there's a couple things in this. I do think we need a way for parents and teachers to share their concerns with the digital curriculum department. Something more direct. Coming through us, I mean, I'm glad to when people email me or tell me what's going on or complaints, I connect them just like Ms. Flynn said she does. But I think there needs to be something where they can explain their concerns, you know, what it is they're truly frustrated by or what they see could be changed and their suggestions, because it is something we're learning. And I do think, and I heard this today too, and I've heard it over and over again, I think we really need to look at iReady. I really think there's something there, and it's not, when you hear something once or you hear something twice, but when you hear it over and over and over again from different areas, not just teachers, but parents and everyone, students, well, the little kids don't even know to express it. But there's something about iReady that I think we need to look at. So I'm just making that plea right now for Dr. Jenkins and her staff to, you know, really kind of look at it, especially with the little guys. I think from what I'm hearing, it's taking away their love for learning and their engagement in the process. And I just don't know if the little guys need as much digital time as the older kids. Obviously, the older students love it. So it's just something I want to make sure we do look at, because when you hear something over and over again, there's a reason.
Ms. Cadle.
Well, I want to set the record straight for a couple of things. There have been some reference to taking the money and using it for field trips and salaries. Okay, well, the money from the computers comes from the halfpenny sales tax. And before we went for the halfpenny sales tax last time, if we go back in history, this board believed that the community would say we need to harden our schools, because school shootings was what we kept hearing about. And we really and truly thought that we were going to hear hardening of schools was the number one thing we should do with the halfpenny sales tax. Mm-hmm. Guess what? The community wanted computers. Hardening of schools didn't even show up as something that this community wanted. This sales tax that came in 2002, I'm lucky because my district has totally been rebuilt, and I leave here with the last school opening in August to be rebuilt. The schools that I represented were the oldest schools in this community, and they were falling apart. And I leave this board with the fact that the teachers in District 1 have bathrooms that work and they don't smell. They have safe schools. We have fixed most of the traffic problems. And I am proud of that. But to say that we could take the money that we're getting in the sales tax and go on field trips and pay for salaries, you cannot do that. That's capital dollars. There is an iron curtain that says capital dollars cannot go to those things. So I just want to set the record straight on that one. The second thing, my board members have been worried about me today because, to be honest with you, I've been in a really bad mood since 6:30 this morning. I mean, bad. And I do it to myself because I watch the news starting at 5 o'clock in the morning. And so I even watch the cycles. So when I come in, I can say, well, here's what this channel reported at 5, and this is what they reported at 5:30, and here's how they built it till 7 o'clock. I have worked hard. And Wendy, you need to know, Mr. Floyd, I'm so happy for him, but I ended up at Trinity Prep because of the teacher walkout. We had moved here from Polk County. I was a student at Winter Park High School, and 4 of my teachers walked out. My father was a businessman who had 5 children who just came to a new county. And he's like, if this is what public schools are like, I can't have my children in these schools. So I get criticized for not graduating from Winter Park High School. But it was because 4 of my teachers walked out that my father said, you're 16 years old and you're going where I tell you you're going, and you're going to a private school. So I understand that you're proud of it, but I'm telling you, I was a victim of not being able to finish a public school, because my teachers walked out. And I was left there with no instruction. So, Mr. Sublett, I couldn't have said it any better than you did. I appreciate you taking the lead on this to set the record straight. And one of the things that I was going to ask the superintendent to do, and because I wrote it down on my little list, there were some references to our finances and how we were using them by one of the speakers. And I think we need to set the record straight on that. We keep hearing how many teachers are leaving. I want to know the exact number. I know we see that report from time to time, but I would like to see that again because I keep hearing that teachers are leaving, and I'd like to see the data on it. So I was going to bring that up later in the meeting, and thank you very much. And I really am in a much better mood since you said what you needed to say because you did it way more eloquently than I would have.
Thank you. Usually I aggravate you. That's a plus.
I've been aggravated all day. You know I've been aggravated. So,
Mrs. Gordon.
Well, thank you. Well, I think a lot has been said. And I haven't heard a lot from any of the teachers, and if you want to, you know, I've been doing school visits, and I talk to the teachers, and I keep hearing, can we get this? Can you get that? And then I'll go to Dr. Jenkins, and I say, can you make that happen over there in my school? But I think all of us up there are extremely proud. I know I am. I was in one of the cities in my district last night. And I think I called Dr. Jenkins raising. I was just hollering and screaming. And then she wasn't answering. And then I called John Morris, and I was hollering and screaming, and he didn't answer. And then I called Woody, bless his little soul, he answered. And he had to hear me hollering and screaming because we got kicked out of the meeting last night. But I asked him to have mercy on us and allow us an opportunity to talk and get together. I think a lot of times we are totally misinformed and disrespected. I think I'm disrespected by my own union. And Ulysses trained me. I have just as many years as Ulysses teaching. I worked with Ulysses' wife. I served as vice president of CTA for many wonderful years. I've been on the national level with AFT, NEA, NSBA, I can go on and on. I had missed a convention, but my own unit never said anything to me. So I ran for president. And because I love Cliff so, I walked out. I quit. And Ulysses had just walked out 3 months before I came to Orange Center Elementary. They had just walked up, but I was in a tumultuous place. I was in Charleston, South Carolina, teaching at my high school. While they were walking out, Florida didn't do what we did in South Carolina. We fought, and we went to jail, and we marched, and the teachers, we had a struggle, but we had great leadership in NEA. Most of us I keep talking to Dr. Jenkins, let's create our own teachers. They created me from eighth grade. My high school was eighth grade to 12. It was mandatory if you wanted to be a teacher, you were a member of NEA student. And we went to the NEA conventions. And I was impressed at what I saw at the convention. That's why I wore my hats and I wore my gloves, because of what I saw in teachers. And I became a strong leader, but I was disrespected by my own union. I am the oldest active union member. I am a life member in Orange, and I'm going to say that. I am a voice up here for you, and I do know that everybody up here is a voice for you. I can tell you the weakest voice up here, and I can tell you the strongest voices up here. But for some reason, you disrespect your strongest voices. And there is a lack of communication that bothers me. For some reason, you still haven't gotten the hung of how to collaborate collectively. I fought for that for you. I was trained by the best. Ulysses is my neighbor. His wife and I were guidance counselors together. We worked. She was a teacher. I mean, his next door neighbor, because his neighbor wife was a guidance counselor, Mr. Cosby. Ms. Cosby, you all heard that story. But I've been in Orlando 51 years as an educator. I'm still teaching today. And I told you, I love where I teach. I don't make it miserable. I love my principal. And like I said, if that principal is not leading that school, that's where the rubber meets the road. Then something is wrong, because it ain't nothing right, pretty much, with education. But I'd be darned if I would stay on this board and let, I'm just going to say it out, Teach for America take over. I spoke to Dr. Jenkins about that. Thank you, Teach for America, for helping me and all of my schools. But your 3 years working with us and your 5 weeks of experience doesn't stand up to my 50 years of teaching. I've done 25 years of teaching in Orange. I taught in South Carolina. I'm teaching in Osceola. This is my 23rd year in Osceola as a teacher. I am a union member. I've been a building rep. I started OESPA with a group of us. It started at Orange Center. And I thought about it, because I saw people not being treated right. But for some reason, you haven't gotten the hung of it. The best time we ever had was when Cliff McInturf became president of CTA. And I stepped down and quit teaching to go do something else because of the frustration in this county. I know what it's like to quit. I've been fired in Orange County from Inglewood and Darrell Tate. That's one of my favorite schools. And when the principal died, I didn't go to her funeral. I'm sorry. And nor did anybody, because she was roughly mean. I'm being honest with you. And she made it miserable for everybody. You gotta communicate. We can't even have subs at my school because it's court ordered. So we have to sub. We collectively and collaboratively team teach, so that we could get a break. My principal would say, if you gotta go, go. You could make it up. Come time, do this, get out of here. I told you that. Sometimes she'd run us out. Don't stay. I don't want you staying. Nobody have to see you walk off the job, because it ain't gonna happen like that. I tell teachers at my school every day, your husband's gonna be mad at you. Why? There you go with that bag, and you got all that stuff you lugging out the door. Why don't we work together and get your papers all, work together. We gotta think smarter and stop working harder. You've heard it over and over again, teachers. We have got to stop fighting each other over things that we pretty much don't have too much control of, unless you make the difference. If you're not talking over here and they're not talking over here, and you've never discussed that this is a problem, some of this I heard tonight, I'd never heard before. And I'm getting things out of my school, but when I get it, I'd be lying to the superintendent. And you know what? She immediately does something about it. So I don't know who you all are talking to and where you, I know how we do in the lounge, because I'm a teacher, but I'm not a lounge person. I'm a person that's going to get it done, and I'm a person that's going to see that the teacher I'm working with be successful. That's the way I am. If I move up, you move up. If I don't move up, you're going to move up. I have to look out for others. If I see something in apparel, all of my teachers pretty much at my school are homegrown. They started as paras, and now they have doctor's degrees, and they have masters, and we're in this subbing. Some of them are struggling because they can't pass the teacher's test. So there's still a para. Who is to blame for that? And they work harder than we do. And our paras have to do everything that a teacher have to do. I'm saying to you tonight, CTA, OESPA, let's get together. If it means this board and you talking to us with dialogues, I need to know the root cause of everything. Because I'm not getting everything you're getting. And if I have to do it with my school, I'll send out my own survey. Wendy and I had it about the survey. I said, Wendy, let's go build membership. I was the membership chair. We won membership at the state level, and I saw you got one, Wendy, at the last meeting. You know I went to all of them. I didn't miss nothing. I was always a national delegate, and I was always a local delegate for FEA. But we got to find out, like they said, this is a right-to-work state. How ridiculous it is for the legislator to try to vote out the union when this is our own voice. We don't vote out the doctors' union. We don't vote out the lawyers' bar association. They don't vote out anybody's organization but ours because they control us. So we need power, ladies and gentlemen. We have got to use our voice like we did in the 60s, like we were taught in the 50s and 60s, to use our voice, use our power. Your board needs to be walking hand in hand with you. And when that lady got up tonight and say, vote them out, who you going to get that know anything that's going to carry you forward? You don't have to vote anybody out. We're all going to be out because we want to get out. You want to walk out, we want to get out too. But we made a commitment to our constituents. All of us want out up here. But how could you just walk away and let people come in that know nothing, never been to a board meeting, but all of a sudden they're going to come and win you over. You never seen them supporting teachers, but now they're all in here tonight trying to become candidates. Beware wolves in sheep clothing. I'm through.
Ms. Gould.
I want to thank my board members for saying most of things, but I want to kind of bring it to some of the things that I heard that I do agree with tonight. I do think we need to walk in unity, and I know that wasn't directed to us, but we do need to walk in unity. We heard about the retired teacher, and I think she's left, but that talked about the privatization of the school system across our country, and it's certainly happening here in Florida. There's a lot of things undermining, and I know there's issues to be dealt with, but if we don't become a common chorus and we don't start educating the community about our neighborhood schools and what is right about them, not that we don't have to work through the challenges, but what is right about them, we're going to lose the war for the battle. Because I went to D.C. for the first time last week to work the legislature, and what I heard up there was, and I'm Pollyanna, anybody who knows me, I believe in can do anything, and I am Pollyanna, and I never lose that spirit of we can always do better, but it is scary, the movement that is happening across the country and the undermining of our children. But even worse than that, it's the undermining of our economy. It's the absolute undermining of our economy. And it's a scary thing. This is a little sidebar, but I was standing with a school board member from Ohio, and Ohio is pretty much all charter schools, and they even have more separation with their school districts than we do here. There's zero oversight. There was a school district, a virtual school district, that claimed they had 40,000 children, had two teachers, and took their second payment in January and then went out of business. So 40,000 students K through 12. And it was a virtual charter school. And I have great charter schools in my area. There's great charter schools. But that charter school wasn't in it for our kids. That charter school was in it for the paycheck. That's what we're fighting. And we have issues that we have to get through here locally. We have to, you know, work with our, nothing replaces a teacher. We have to work within what we're trying to do. We're trying to career path kids. not college and career, career path. College is a way to careers. We're trying to career path kids, and we need to align everything we can with our little bit of local authority and ability to help kids get to that. And we need to be in partnership in doing that. And we need to be educating together our community. Do you know in Orange County that we're pretty popular? We have 1,000 families a month moving into Orange County. Where are they going to school and why are they coming here? Because we have a great community to live in. And the anchor of that great community is our school system. Do we need improvements? Yes. Some of which we will continue to work on here because we're evolution, not revolution. And some will have to go to Tallahassee, and some we have to go even to the federal for. But there's also opportunities that have been opened up. I want to bring it back to kind of the digital blended learning. I know a friend of mine from Lockheed Martin has started a tutoring group on his own. He's now working with our transformation department to try to bring tutors who can't leave work for 3 hours to do this, but can do it virtually and do it through Skype and FaceTime and use some tools out there. It's also opening up doors that we've never been able to open before and bring community in to support our schools in a way that that hasn't happened. Evolution, not revolution. We've started this in the last 5 years. We need to perfect it. We need to make sure blended learning is really blended learning and not computer babysitting. I don't think any of our teachers do that, but we have to make sure. We still have books. We still want people to love books. We still have book fairs. I know that I stop by book fairs all the time, and kids love book fairs, especially the elementary school students. We still have media centers that are becoming these great collaborative gathering spaces. It's amazing what you're seeing happen in the media centers. So let's not demonize everything and make it all black and white, because there is no black and white. The only thing that is black and white in our system is that we all want to put our students first, and we have to find the right pathways collaboratively and collectively to do that. You know, revenues in this state, and this was part of my communications report, so I'll get it out of the way now. Revenue in this state has gone up dramatically. Orange County property values have gone up $23 billion since 2008. Our expenditure on students has gone like this while revenues has gone up. Our expenditure on education like this, revenue like this. There's something wrong with that picture when we're not investing in our teachers and our students and what we're delivering, which is the future economy.
Ms. Flynn. Ms. Moore.
You all didn't leave me a whole lot of things to comment on, but I appreciate what you said. And I think you're hearing frustration in the audience, and we're frustrated too. You can hear it coming back from us back out here, because we just had cast a really tough vote to sue the state of Florida and had a not so nice letter from the commissioner last week that went, oh my goodness, you know, they really do hold a whole lot of power on us. And then we had quickly about face a little bit on something that none of us really wanted to do. But what so without repeating everything you've all said, I just remembered the group from Puerto Rico. I think it was VPR that came in, who did an incredible job. They had a request. They really honed in on what they wanted. They didn't throw barbs at us, forget that we're actually friends. We're really involved in the same fight, but we understand people need to come and invent, and we get it, and this is the easiest place to come. They're not driving to Tallahassee and screaming at the legislators. They come here, and we understand that. But the VPR group was very systematic how they went about their work, and they got everything they asked for and more. And if you think about how they went about the process, they made appointments to see each one of us. We had an hour-long conversation. listened to one another. We made suggestions. And I know we said be collaborative. Tell us what you need, which is the same way Dr. Jenkins runs her teacher roundtables. What is it you need? So some of our students, what the parents and I were saying, we really want to have more time on instruction with our teachers. I could hear that coming out of the group. And so I think when advocates come in here, there's a lot more work to be done. There's meetings with the board members. There's really honing in on what you're asking. There's making sure that your data is right on and it's accurate. And remember, we're your partners. We were elected to represent you, and we're doing that. We're not always going to agree, but there's not a person up here who wouldn't listen, wouldn't take an hour meeting, that doesn't respond to an email or a phone call. And so you can hear a little bit of the angst going back this way, because we want to be your partners. We don't want to be your enemies. And we're not. We just got done suing the state of Florida on behalf of our kids. If you think that that was an easy vote or that's an easy place to be, it is not. So we have to remember, divided, we're going to fall. Together, we'll be successful. And we do value the children. We do want the children with an integral interaction with a teacher who is paid for what they do every single day. And if any one of us could wave a magic wand and give everybody a 20% raise, we would do it right now. It's not that we don't want to. So if we do our homework, we meet with the board members and we figure out exactly what we're asking for, or asking for a new process like VPR did, we're going to make more success than just having venting sessions. Thank you.
Ms. Cadle.
Ms. Cobert.
All right. So I think we've gotten way off topic.
Yeah, bring us back in.
So I just want to take the opportunity to go ahead and express my opinion on a couple of things. I greatly value the input of the speakers that came to speak tonight, both at the pre-agenda and at this meeting, because indeed I did fight very hard to gain that access for the public, to make it very easy for citizens to come and address this board. That was very important to me. So I appreciate all of those comments. But I do want to set the record straight on a couple of things. And one is the inference that this board, this body, does not fight Tallahassee on the things that have come down the pipeline. I just spent 4 days in our state capitol last week, away from my family, away from my child, working on behalf of the teachers and the children in this district. Spent a lot of time last year fighting for the right to dispense with VAM. We got that passed, despite a lot of the bad things that were passed and the continued encroachment on our public schools. We did have some wins. This year, we had a legislator who filed a bill to get rid of merit pay. Merit pay has been here since 2011. This board directed our own staff to do the research to prove that merit pay has no bearing on student success. And that legislator that filed that bill last week in Tallahassee in front of the entire Florida School Boards Association credited Orange County with making him see the light and gave him the inspiration to write that bill. It didn't go anywhere this year. One of the reasons it didn't go anywhere is because he's being punished for voting no on the big education train bill this year, HB 7055. We are having some incremental influence up there, and we're fighting very, very hard. So the inference that this body is not doing its job on that front, I have a really hard time with. The speakers that spoke earlier, the teachers, I want to speak to you directly. I want you to know that we are listening. We do hear you. Yesterday, I sat with the superintendent and gave some examples of the things that I've heard from teachers and real solid solutions that we can bring to them. I hear from them.
about planning time, that their planning time is important, that they enjoy the Kahneman planning time, but oftentimes it's disrupted. Maybe an administrator comes in and takes that opportunity to have a meeting with them, and then guess what? They didn't get to do their planning, and they have to go back and do that. Though there are examples of things like that that we can do to ensure that that time is sacred and take those that extra time off of their plate. Professional development. Professional development is great. Teachers love that. But it needs to be development that is good for the individual teacher. So perhaps the entire school doesn't need to come to every professional development. It should be directed. Teachers should have the autonomy to let their supervisors know what professional development would help them. And that would take hours off of their plate as well and give them that is the autonomy. Time and autonomy are the two things that we hear all the time. Data collection. There's some data collection that needs to be had. We have to take attendance every day. We have to report our grades. But there are some pieces, there are some principals who have found ways, Mrs. Flynn has great examples of that, principals who have found ways to take some of that burden off the teacher's plate, and we can extrapolate that out into other schools and use that as a best practice. There are some areas, like if you have some of our severe ESE children, there are state and federal forms that have to be filled out by law, and they take an enormous amount of time. We can find ways to support those teachers and help them with that, and again, relieve them of some of that so that they can get back and concentrate on doing their jobs. And the fourth area that I'm hearing consistently is about student discipline. So something very, very important. And as we are trying to reduce suspensions and reduce students that are being out of the classroom, because when they're out of the classroom, they're not learning. However, we can't refer a child to the office and they be sent directly back to the teacher, where the teacher then has that instructional time that is lost and that burden in their classroom. We have to find a balance. I want you to know that we do support our teachers. We are looking for real solutions, and those solutions are coming from the teachers, from our roundtables, our forums, from your forum at the CTA. I just want to let you know that we hear you. We have those conversations up on the ninth floor. The superintendent is hearing from us, and we're trying to work together. And I would ask you to work with us, to work alongside of us. I have said that a long time. We are not on opposite sides. We are all on the side of the children. And the only way we're going to make positive change is for us to do it together. That's it. Thank you.
Ms. Cadle.
I'm not going to take long because Mrs. Cobert just said what I was going to talk about is the fact Mrs. Gould was 4 days away from her family. Ms. Flynn, Ms. Cobert were 3 days away from their families, up there fighting for local control, for us to do what's right, and for people to think we haven't been fighting. You guys know I've laughed for years because I was on the executive committee of the Florida School Boards Association for 6 years. And I was in D.C. I was in Tallahassee. We have been fighting. A lot of times it falls on deaf ears. But to assume we are not fighting and we are not talking to people. And, I mean, I talk to them when I see them at the Winter Park Christmas Parade. I get more done at that Winter Park Christmas Parade when we're all sitting there waiting to go out. I can tell them exactly what's important and what they need to look at. We had a meeting yesterday, the Central Florida Public School Boards Coalition, 13 school boards that are all as frustrated as we are. I wrote Senator Stewart yesterday, and I wrote Representative Cortez. And I used my personal email, because I wasn't writing as a school board member, I was writing as a voter to let them know, pull the budget out of whatever, you guys are better at the numbers, whatever, 70, 55 or whatever, mm-hmm. Separate them. Let, you know, deal with the education things,
separate than the budget. Don't tie it. Stay strong. And I wrote the same thing to Senator Stewart. She's my senator. And I said, you've got to separate these two. Senate, stay strong. Don't let it become a train again. So to assume we're not doing things is perhaps not accurate. So I just wanted to kind of say we've been doing this for years.
Well, thank you, board members. Clearly, I think just to wrap this up, it hit a nerve with us, and I think it hit a nerve with me, because the implication tonight was that this board was putting teachers last. And the irony of that is we had just come from a planning meeting where we were strategizing how we are going to campaign the voters to renew the one mill property tax. And that property tax wouldn't be on the ballot and wouldn't pass if we weren't out there fighting for it and fighting to get it passed. And it's not the first time that we've done it. It's the third time. And I really don't know. I said to one of the speakers earlier, whose husband I've known a long time, that I've never figured out, other than convenience and the fact that our boardroom is within 10 to 30 minutes of your members, why you descend on us to lobby us on issues that you really need to be descending on Tallahassee for. I'm going to show you a little chart that came out of our meeting. This state has enjoyed tremendous prosperity the last 4 or 5 years. Property values are skyrocketing in this state. I perhaps know a little bit more about this than the average person, because I formerly chaired the Education Appropriations Committee in Tallahassee, which, by the way, I was named, and I know this is a bit self-serving, Legislator of the Year by the Classroom Teachers Association of Orange County while I was up there. We've been fighting for public education, all of us, for years up here. And what this chart shows is that, as you well know, especially some of the more educated there amongst you, and personally pretty much all the union leaders are as educated as any of us are on these issues, the legislature, notwithstanding skyrocketing property values, has been ratcheting back every single year what's called the required local effort, a millage that's assessed. If I could get the unions of the state to do one thing, it's very, very simple legislative message: lobby your legislators to leave the RLE, the required local effort, alone. If the millage that we pay on taxes, property taxes, had simply remained the same over the last 5 years, the amount that we could fund for teacher salaries would have gone up dramatically. The only reason the teachers in this county have received decent raises is because the voters of this county have opted to renew the one mill property tax, not once, not twice, but hopefully a third time here this year as well. If you look at this chart, I know you all can't see it out there. On a state funding level, our funding has actually decreased dramatically over the last 5 years, notwithstanding rising property values and dramatic increases, as the local millage, which is the most we're allowed to assess, we have no say in this, has dropped from 5.26 mills in 2015 to 4.2 mills, which means that our funding has dropped dramatically over that time, and it's only been made up for the local option. On a purchasing power standpoint, if you could see this chart back here, our per student funding has dropped from $7,309 per student in 2007 to 10 years later, $7,231 per student. So when you take into account health insurance increases, inflation, the drop in purchasing power, it's dropped dramatically. Those of you in the audience who know how we fund teacher salaries and education and put teachers first know it's completely funded by the state of Florida through the FEFP finance program. And the ire that was expressed tonight really needs to be expressed at your legislators. And yet what I don't understand is you keep electing the same folks again and again and again who are not your friends up there, when we have nothing that we can do about it down here. And what I also don't understand is you've got an incredibly friendly school board up here for teachers and for the union, and I'm not sure that even your union leadership realizes, I think some of you in this room do realize, the strength of the national movement sweeping this country by a deep-pocketed charter school industry, which is literally spending millions of dollars on local school board races. Biggest threat to the survival of local public education, a local neighborhood school? Is this board being replaced by candidates funded by the charter school industry? And we're not hostile to charters, but we do believe in accountability. Charter schools across the board are non-union. You worry about decertification, you're not going to have a voice at it. And there are entire school districts that have been converted to charter, and entire swaths of school systems that have been converted to charter. And with complete respect to the educators union, I've run eight times in this community. I've won six of those races. I've received minimal support from the union, and that's fine. But it's not that important to us when we run for office. And I don't have an agenda here because, you know, I'm leaving this office. It's just not that important. But the amount of money that the charter school industry will pour into local races, especially against a board like ours that has sued the state of Florida over those issues, I mean, I just, it's a clarion call. You're going to have an entire board, if you're not careful, that is anti-public school, anti-neighborhood public school, and really wants to privatize education entirely. And the last thing I'll say is, I want to end on a constructive note. Y'all are better at union organizing than I will ever be. I'm not a union member. My wife actually is a union member, but I haven't organized on behalf of the union. But I think tonight was a little bit of political theater to try to fight off the threat of decertification. I may be wrong about that, but I actually asked Ms. Cobra, why is this coming before us tonight? Nothing we heard tonight was new. Testing's been around, and we've been railing against it along with y'all for 8 years that I've been on this board. Classroom observations have been around for years. And a light bulb went off when I started to see all the news stories hit that this is about the threat of decertification. And I guess where I'm going with this is, I don't know, maybe this will work for y'all to boost up the union membership. But I think, for me personally, a much more productive approach would be to approach individual members of this board, and I'll give you my commitment right now, I would do this, to go out there and sign a letter and actively campaign and encourage teachers to join the union and let teachers know how important it is that we have a strong union. We don't want the union decertified. We enjoy our working relationship with you, and it would be, frankly, chaos and anarchy if we didn't have an effective union to collaborate with. But we have a bully pulpit, many of us up here, and we command voices. Let us help in the efforts to drive up the union membership and get more teachers to join the union and participate in union, because we think it's a good thing, and we think it's a constructive thing, and it will help. So enough said on all that. Mrs. Gordon, do you want to say anything to land us, and Mrs. Robinson, then we'll vote in the consent agenda.
Yes, being the only certified union member. Oh, Ms. Robinson, go.
Who am I taking someone's spot?
No. Okay, thank you. You said so many good words. I mean, I love what you just came out of your mouth. You're the first chairman of a board or a board member that is non-union that I've ever heard say anything in what you said. It is a good thing. I wrote it down to encourage membership. I think that has already been taking place. Most of us up here know we cry when a teacher comes before us and they're not a board, a union member. The first thing we usually ask, Madam Superintendent, please just let's find out with our general counsel if they are union members. If they are, we might pull it off the agenda. I think you saw how we have fought for teachers. Wendy, you know it. You got to speak on our behalf because nobody else comes to the meeting. You are here when you see we are fighting for teachers and have gotten them back in their job, other than if they really did blow it. If they're not members, it's very difficult because they don't understand in a right-to-work state, the only voice you have is your union. And you won't join it, teachers. Paraprofessionals, you won't join it. I get on Wendy, like I say all the time, get your membership up. Get it up. And for Bill to say, I recruit daily. I've sent them to Osceola County and where I'm a member active, and I've sent them to Orange where I am life, NEA, FEA. Yes, I don't use my name, but from now on, when they come to join, my name will be on the application. I used to get awards at NEA and FEA for bringing in membership. Wendy, you know that. I'd go up on the stage and get my membership money. Oh, I'm not supposed to say that. Lord, don't take me off the jail. Okay? So what I'm saying, it's a right to work state. It is a good thing for you to encourage the membership. But let me tell you this. I'd like to know from the president. Don't answer. You can text me. You can email me. We text back and forth when we need to. How many charter school teachers are members of the union? But yet we had to pay out the other day $3 million of your tax dollars. Not one of them that I know, when I was in your chair as vice president of CTA, joined the union. And I have 6 charter schools in my district. Other board members have about 10 in their district. All of these down at the bottom here are charter schools in the districts. And I want to know, my God, Bill just said, what a boost you would have if you would just go and ask Aloma and Orange County Prep and UCP Prep and Accents Charter and Renton Charter. I can go on down the line. If you want a list, I'll give you this list tonight. That's membership. They are educators and they are teachers. So why won't they join? We're their only voice. No one else can help them in the state of Florida but a personal lawyer. And one time we used to hear everybody, but I don't know, Wendy, I don't think we're doing it anymore. I think some of you give them one conference or maybe two. When I was there, we only gave them one or two conferences. But they won't even join us, and we are their voice. So you are either with me or you're against me. And for me to hear tonight, for a chairman of a school board to say that he encourages membership, which I've been preaching the 50 years I've been in this county. I came fighting for membership, always fought for it, and I've won many awards for membership of CTA. And again, I'm going to say served as membership chair. And I wasn't just sitting there. I worked. So I'm here to tell you, we need more voices, and all these people who claim they're with us, they don't even vote educational issues. They vote their issues. And they're sitting out there, and they need to be a part of our voice. And why? Because it is a right to work state. We're not like New York and Chicago and all those places where it is mandatory to be in the union. And it's just this gruntledness and fighting and bickering. We don't need to have that here. It is optional, but it's people like me that pay double dues so that we can have a voice in the state of Florida. And then there are teachers sitting in our school that pays no dues and get the same paycheck and the same benefit that we get. So what I'm saying is, guys, we're not the enemy. We just need to get our thoughts together, and I'm going to ask that we, Dr. Jenkins, let's see if we need to have a round table. You do round tables with teachers. I'm going to request that you do a round table with the board and CTA, with their executive cabinet or whatever, because we need to get to the bottom of it. We don't hear everything that you hear. We don't see everything you see. And we all read those 1,000 comments from those teachers. We all read it. We tore that paper apart. And we even reported back to the public. Even though that was a handful, we don't have time to fill out those surveys. Most people are not going to fill out a survey. So you need to talk, and let's see, when we talk, Dr. Jenkins, let's see if we could come up with some administrative alternatives that can take place in these schools. Because I know that we could do it, I've seen it done, and we do have a lot of successful schools out there. And everybody's not disgruntled, but all of us ready to get out of here. Thank you.
All right. Robinson, bring us in for a landing.
Can do. When I spoke originally, I tried to keep my comments specifically to the agenda item that we're on at the moment, which is digital learning. And we've really, I stayed on topic. But I have to say, I'm going off topic now, because I have to say that in response to the comments of why the CTA came to us tonight, I went to an issues summit that they held back in December, and they've been talking about these things since way before the union bill came up, and they've been talking about the fact that they want to have a day or week or whatever where we work to the contract. So I think the timing just kind of happened. I don't think they ginned this up just because of that. I think the timing just kind of came along. So I just wanted to come and explain that this has been going on for a long time, and you didn't just do that for that. And I enjoyed. And I hold on, Wendy. I'm sorry. Can't. So anyway, I just wanted to make that point that I did start hearing all of the concerns that I heard tonight as well back in early December. So that's before this ever happened. So that's. I just want to make sure that. So I am not going to say anything else because I did try to stay on topic. Thank you.
All right. So Ms. Robinson moves that we adopt a consent agenda. Correct. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
It's been seconded by Mrs. Gordon. Is there any further debate or discussion of that motion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed, nay. Consent agenda is adopted. Baldwin Park parents, I'm sorry that took so long. Sometimes we get accused of not spending enough time on business up here. You can't say that this
and
night. We spent almost an hour and a half on business. So thank you for coming down, and congratulations. So, and Ms. Dormal, thank you for coming down as well.
Yes.
All right, so we are now on non-consent.
1701,
which is to actually name the school. Thank you, guys. All right, so, all right, do you want to make the motion?
Yes.
Mr. Wright needs to go to Dr. Jenkins.
Thank you, Chairman. Area Superintendent John Wright will bring you the summary of recommendation for this evening.
Good evening, Chairman Sublette, distinguished board members, and Superintendent Jenkins. It's my pleasure to be here tonight on behalf of the children and the stakeholders of the Audubon Park Relief School to ask you to consider a name for their new school. For many years, the school building located at 1750 Commonway Road in Orlando has been the temporary home of Audubon Park Elementary School. That former school building over the past decade has been used for various purposes. It's been used as a swing site for other schools that have been rebuilt, such as Brookshire, Princeton, Lake Silver. Finally, the school has been demolished, the old building, and it's finally been rebuilt and will reopen next year as the Audubon Park K-8 school. And so it is now time for the swing site school to be named. For the past several months, Principal Ferratusco and her school advisory council, they've engaged stakeholders in the process to consider potential names for the school, ideas about the mascot, school colors. So I really do want to thank Principal Ferratusco and the school advisory council for their leadership around that. There's also a great group of teachers here tonight, of staff members, administrators, and parents who have all really been part of the process, and they wanted to come out here and support their school, their new school, and support you as you make your decision. So thank you for hanging in there with us tonight and being here. Over 1,100 stakeholders provided input around the final three choices for the names, and many of the key stakeholders also submitted letters of support. You can see the overwhelmingly favorite name was Baldwin Park Elementary School. We have letters of support from the PTA president, Stephanie Harley, from Diana Hanna, the support person of the year, from Brandy Weiss, who is the SAC chairperson, from Wendy Moses, who's the Falcon Fund president for the school, from the teacher of the year, Aaron Albert, and then from some student leaders, from Mrs. Braun's fifth grade class, Diego Rodriguez, Stella Chiklis, Julie Weiss, and Trinity Seuss. And all of these stakeholders have, they wanted to say that they respected the process and enjoyed being part of the process, and they also wanted to lend support for the recommended new name, Baldwin Park Elementary School. So board members, thank you for your consideration, and Superintendent Jenkins.
Mrs. Robinson.
We've waited for this forever. It's the longest swing site, I think, in history of OCPS. It's been 10 years in a swing site. They never put a name on the building because it was really a swing site. So it's really exciting. It was no big surprise to me when I saw the numbers that Baldwin Park, I mean, come on, guys, it's right in the middle of Baldwin Park, that that was the name that was overwhelmingly chosen. So it is my proud privilege tonight to move the adoption of, make sure I say this correctly, of Baldwin Park Elementary, to select the name of Baldwin Park Elementary for the relief school located at 1750 Commonway Road, Orlando, Florida, 32814. Do I have a second? Okay. And I want to say, let's go and do the vote, and then I want to talk about it.
Okay. All right. Well, again, congratulations. So, board members, any debate or discussion of the good motion? All right. Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye. 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 All opposed, nay. Show it adopted unanimously.
Yay. And it's really exciting. They're going to be the Baldwin Park Bobcats, which is so cool because they've got the Winter Park Wildcats right nearby and the Glen Ridge Lions. So they're staying in the cat family, which is awesome, and their colors will be navy and silver. So very exciting. So you'll now get a name actually put up on your building in time for school to open in the fall. So thank you all for working so well, and I understand Ms. Faratuska had to be at her son's birthday party tonight, so we miss her, but we're so thankful all of you are here. Congratulations.
So congratulations again, and you know, I'm going to editorialize, and I've done too much of that tonight, but I am so glad, this is just a pet peeve of mine, that you all named the school after the neighborhood and the area you're in. Sometimes we come up with names that sound very California to me, like Pleasant Valley and Sunnyvale. I like schools that are named after places that they are. So congratulations. Thank you for your wise selection. And I know y'all have waited for years for this. For kudos. Kudos. So you can go home now and have a milkshake. Oh, God. All right. Board members, we are on Superintendent's Report. Dr. Jenkins.
Thank you, Chairman. Just a couple of things. Let me mention, actually I have five things. Let me mention, Ms. Cagle asked about the instructional turnover. I would remind you, back when Dr. Williams did her report from HR, I'm going to have that chart put back back online for you, so you'll have easy access to it. So our turnover includes resignations, voluntary, as well as terminations that are involuntary, retirements, and leave because of health issues as well. And just for the record, so no one misunderstands, our turnover actually went down by almost 2.2 percentage points from the previous year last year. For our retirees, that went down from 2.6 down to 1.6. Our involuntary, meaning we terminated some folks, went up by 0.2 percentage points. Our voluntary was down slightly as well, down from 7.6 to 7.48. And then our total turnover, you'll have the chart, our total turnover, you can even go back in Board Docs and look at the previous presentation, it went down from 12.8 down to 10.4, lower than the state average, if I recall. So I wanted to make sure no one misunderstands and thinks somehow our turnover has skyrocketed. It has actually gone down. But throughout the state of Florida, there was a continual increase in turnover. Last year, fortunately, we had a very nice downtick as well. Secondly, question about the budget. I'm going to ask Mr. Kelly, actually, at the next budget committee meeting to bring those clarification. There were some misstatements. That individual used to be in budget committee meeting. She is no longer a part of the bargaining unit. So I believe our president understands some of that information around non-recurring dollars, but Mr. Kelly will certainly bring that back again to budget committee. Thirdly, I'm sorry, while I'm on budget, let me also mention, so pleased that our own representative Stephanie Murphy in the last federal budget that was passed actually got dollars set aside for our students that have joined us from Puerto Rico and the U.S. Virgin Islands, significant dollars set aside that are to be processed immediately by the Department of Education at the federal level. $10,000 for displaced students with disabilities, $9,000 for each displaced student that is an ELL learning English, and $8,500 for displaced students who do not have a disability nor the ELL language needs. We are ecstatic, appreciate Congresswoman Stephanie Murphy for her diligence. We're just very excited about that. Wanted to publicly thank her for her efforts. Thirdly, I have, let me hold the video. Don't run the video until I tell you to. Let me mention in this legislative session, the budget. Per student funding on the Senate budget, in case anyone's curious, has an increase of only 1.5%. It includes a reduction in the base student allocation of $45.20 per student. It includes new categorical funding for mental health, HOPE supplements, and Best and Brightest. Of course, you know all about the rollback of the RLE. House budget per student funding increase of only 1.37%. Base student allocation up by $75. That those dollars seem so minimal when you share that chart. And by the way, Chairman, we'll put both of those charts that you showed, we'll put those online so people have easy access to them. They have no new categorical program, but again, the reduction in the required local effort. The governor's budget per student funding increase of 2.74. So if you're keeping tabs, 1.5 recommended by the Senate, 1.37 by the House, 2.74 in the governor's budget, with an increased base student allocation of an additional $152.45 per student. No new categorical programs in his actual recommendation. And he uses the growth in tax base and increase in state funding to fund the budget. In other words, he does not roll back the required local effort. That's the budget based on the governor's recommendation, the House, and the Senate. 1.5 and 1.37 are certainly disappointing numbers as our economy continues to grow. A little disappointing. And lastly, and let me mention as well, someone asked again what our numbers were like for our students from Puerto Rico. We've actually had some turnover of those students as they either return home or move elsewhere. 2,400 is our current count for our students from Puerto Rico. All right, then lastly, I've got a video to cue up, Evans Community Partnership. Evans High School, as you recall, was our first big community school partnership. It was recently honored with an award given by Mutual of America to our partner, Children's Home Society of Florida, recognition of Evans High School for their community partnership. The foundation chooses one nonprofit community partnership program nationally to honor out of hundreds of submissions. Here's a short clip. The full video can be viewed on YouTube, produced by Mutual of America. Roll the video.
To wire the new voice for Pine Hills and Metro Orlando. Jarvis Wheeler in the building for Evans High School.
Yeehaw.
Trojans doing things, right?
You know.
Jarvis, what's the difference between a regular high school and a community school like Evans?
And we don't have no lights, so I have to use the lights from my camera phone. People don't understand that school lunches sometimes are the only way that kids can eat. They're not happy about Christmas. They're not happy about Thanksgiving because that means they don't eat. What good is learning about algebra if you don't have any food to eat? What good is learning about history if you don't know where your next meal is coming from? Those are things that are important to survival, whereas education, at that point, is just a luxury.
Community Partnership School is the coming together of different organizations that genuinely allows them to flourish. It's about building relationships with each student one at a time. It's about building relationships with our community partners, partner by partner. Every kid deserves a chance to grow up and not be hungry and be healthy, to grow up and to have a place to live that's safe and be able to go to school and learn and grow and develop. They find mentors who love them and show them the way. They see opportunity where they haven't seen opportunity before because they have a relationship with someone who says, take the risk. You can do this. We know you can.
Evans High School is a Title I high school serving over 2,500 students, and over 90% of our children are from low-income families. All students on our campus have the ability to eat for free. Our belief system is that demography for our students does not equal their destiny. We know that with high-quality instruction and also an engaging staff and through the resources and the partnership with the Hub, that our students are going to be successful.
Tonight, the Trojans will be hosting the Soul Bowl here at Evans. The Mighty Trojans will be facing Jones High School. The game will begin at 7 p.m.
During halftime of the game, we're going to bring everybody out and highlight all of the people who will sponsor Evans and our students for scholarships. And our goal was 20,000, and we've already eclipsed that goal, so we're excited.
Motivation, determination, collaboration, communication, replication, graduation, education, jubilation, Evans Community High. We're reaching for the sky.
Thank you.
That was excellent, Dr. Jenkins.
So exciting.
You know, I will say a number of board members up here commented how proud we are of that facility. And, you know, I think anybody watching that wouldn't realize that that's one of our county's highest poverty neighborhoods. And I always say that the facility matters so much because it sends a message to communities that the children in that community are as important as the children in the wealthier suburbs. So thank you to the taxpayers of Orange County. We don't deserve credit for it. They do for passing the half-cent sales tax and making that facility possible. So thank you. Yes, Mrs. Robinson.
I just couldn't leave without saying whoop whoop to my Trojans. That was such a wonderful thing. It's been such a great partnership over the years, and it's just really, really nice to have it highlighted so well by that beautiful video from the Mutual of America, and the event where they did the celebration was a fun day, too. So, and you're right, that building is really beautiful, and it's unique, too. It's a unique building. We don't have a whole lot of them built exactly the same. And thanks to Miss Gordon.
Thank you.
Miss Gordon, back in the day. Well, we fought so hard to keep it built on that site, for starters. That was the big issue when I was running for school board 10 years ago. That was the big issue. And then the fact that Ms. Gordon worked so hard, along with the principal at the time and other people, with some of our legislators, to actually be able to get us out from under the Castaldi theory so we could tear the entire building back. It was the saddest building, and they wanted us to keep the thing intact.
And you worked right side by side.
So disappointing. So thank you always, Ms. Gordon, for fighting for that. And now we just have that beautiful building. And it wouldn't have been the same if we'd had to keep parts of the building. You can't build it as efficiently and as beautifully as when you can start with a clean slate. So,
but do you know what I want? I do want to say to Ms. Robinson, thank you, because we shared the children, and you know, we took the 300 kids. Well, we half of them are mine. She knows it.
Yeah.
Majority of the students go to Evans, live in District 5. And that's why we were able to, you all have just been wonderful. Y'all know you all have, not because you like me, but you gave me everything I wanted, okay?
We love you, Kat.
But you put up with me, and
we
I love
just
it.
Like been, you. We
I,
love
I don't
you.
Care if you like me or not, as long as my children get what they want, okay? But I want to say to you, you never was jealous of me coming on your campus. And you never stopped sharing with me when Barbara and Mr. Blocker, and we, if anybody want to see the old Evans plan, the original one they gave us, a bunch of junk with, I mean, it was just terrible. Black stuff. Susan always shared Evans and Eatonville with me, always. But when you came on board, you all came on like blockbusters, but you always included me in everything with Evans, and I included you with Jones and Daryl, anybody, you know, you came right in. And when we needed to stick together, we did. But I have got to give credit to Reverend Randolph Bracey. He was president of the NAACP at that time. And when we went to that meeting and we saw, and I told you, I said, Nancy, look at this library. They're going to keep it. And I walked you around and I showed you everything. And people came from everywhere and said, let's roll. Let's go with the plan. And I'm kicking Reverend Bracey under the table, said, this cannot happen. And you said, I'm going to work with you and make sure that we may get a new facility. And it wasn't until this board worked hard with the facilities department to get that Gestalt law changed, and we were able to tear that sucker down.
Mm-hmm.
All right? And I thank you from the bottom of my heart, and those parents, that's why the parents out there love me. When Evans got overcrowded, remember they were going to close us. Close Jones, close Evans, close Oak Ridge, and all the elementary schools. You know, you stuck with me then. You didn't say, don't take 300 of my kids. I don't care if they live in your district. You are not going to deplete my school. You said, if you need it to keep Jones alive, and we only had one parent to argue. And Dr. Jenkins called me. She said, we don't have any parents arguing. And we gave that parent that option if she wanted to stay. And then after she got over to Jones, she loved it so much, she said, okay, I didn't want to leave Evans, but I'm okay with it. So I love you for that. I love you for allowing me to share a school. Like Rick Roach and I shared Walker. Mm-hmm. Walker was mine. All the kids at Walker pretty much go to Oak Ridge and they live in my district. Okay? Mm-hmm. And I thank you for that. And I love you for that, because you never said, not one time, not even during the dedication, that was your school. So I love you. Girl, that's why you all are such big winners. So keep it up. And they love you. And they do know that you are the school board member, and I'm the wing beneath your wings.
All I just right. have to say, at that Orange County Counselor event last Friday, where so many administrators and teachers and people got the college and career counselor from Evans won the secondary school counselor of the year. And she was Miss Jennifer Bond. She was our teacher of the year many years ago, and she was top five in the state, and she's now their college and career counselor, and she's just phenomenal. So good things are happening. Yep. Thank you.
Ms. Gould?
Well, I wanted to congratulate you on all of that and also kind of take it to the next step, because what has happened because of that school being an anchor is economic development in that community that, you know, tried to take off for a long time, but the school has been the jewel in the crown of trying to get that done. And now there's bike paths going through, trail paths going through, and the business district has just rallied around and been working with all of the community. But it happened because there was an anchor there of investment by this community and by this board to create such a jewel in that community. So thank you.
Mrs. Gordon.
One other thing, when Mrs. Gould stated what she stated, I think Mrs. Robinson was more involved with Dr. Jenkins had to get me involved in the partnership with the medical and the UCF, she had to introduce me to Miss Nancy Ellis, and she had me going to all these little meetings out at Rollins that it was hard for me to get to, but I went. And then they brought in all these people from New York telling us about their community partnership. But you were well on the way, because once the board approved it, you all took out. And then they knew that we were looking for partners for ACE. So then all of a sudden, after, you know, I sent the letter to Dr. Hicks to see if he would consider a school coming in the community, and would he be a part of it to help? And then when Mr. Block and Dr. Jenkins told me, well, you're going to need more partners if you're going to try to build a school like that. But, you know, thanks to Mr. Morrison and his department, Mr. Morris and his facility team, we were able to build. And I think Channel 9 did do a thing on Wendy Ivy. Wendy Ivy, the lady you saw on the picture, did not miss one community meeting of ACE. I didn't even know who she was in the audience sometime, and she'd come up, hi, Kat, hi, you know, because Dr. Jenkins had introduced us. But I was amazed how she followed the parents, the community, and then they decided they had to get some New York firm or something to commit to them and the hospital and everything, and you guys were well on your way. But I thank you, Dr. Jenkins, for the connection, because Dr. Nancy Ellis at UCF, they're one of our biggest partners right now. And we thank you, and Dr. German, with the offering the doctor's degree to any of the students that get to Jones and graduate and want to be in the medical field, they're well on their way to an education. So when I hear people tell me, a man told me last night in the community in which I was in, when we're trying to get them a new school in there, we don't need that school in this community. What good is that school going to do us in this community? We don't need it. And I looked at him, and some of those schools you have should have been torn down altogether. And then I looked, I said, but you know what? We would have never had won the Brogue. That was your baby, wanting to really win that, even though you couldn't say I want it. You couldn't even apply for it. But you did everything that you were noticed. With Dr. Jenkins' leadership, that we would get it. But those students at Oak Ridge and Jones and Winter Park and the other high schools, they are about to graduate, some of them. They may be juniors now, Dr. Jenkins, if I'm not mistaken. Those kids got a free scholarship to go off to college, and the Broke Foundation paid for it for 4 years. I mean, what else can you ask for? All you could do is all you can do. And all you could do is enough. And I learned that when I worked with Art Williams, when I was selling life insurance. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Gordon.
Amazing how partners are coming.
All right. Report. Great report, Dr. Jenkins. Report by District General Counsel, Mr. Rodriguez.
So, members of the board, I have a lengthy report, but I'm going to save it for executive session, so spare us all. I did want to just point out, through the work of Cody Woody and Eileen Fernandez, that appropriation we got from Washington, D.C., even though they're in Tallahassee, they're also monitoring the federal legislation, so kudos to both of them. I know it's a long, long session to be living out of a suitcase and temporary housing up in Tallahassee. During session, but they're monitoring all of these, and that was a big win for us to be able to recover some of those dollars for our students that we're getting from other districts. So kudos to them.
On that point, Dr. Jenkins, I always believe, because I think sometimes when people go to bat for you, it's important to recognize them. So I don't know if we can do something. I know she's probably very busy, but to bring Congresswoman Murphy here to recognize her and thank her, because, you know.
Address the coalition.
Oh, terrific. Okay, board members, we're on 20. Committee reports. Ms. Gould.
We had a communications committee meeting today, and we're talking about the one mill referendum. and we'll be bringing that back to the board. We've already kind of talked about a lot of the reasons why we feel that we had good discussion about pursuing that again for a third time. So I won't rehash that because I think we've touched on it already tonight. And that is really the outcome. We're working on a proclamation or a resolution to be able to bring back at a later date.
Well, Ms. Gould, thank you for your leadership on this issue. I know you've been working the community hard and talking to some very important corporate partners to make sure they support it. So thank you for that. It's not unnoticed. Legislative, Ms. Flynn.
Thank you. Last week, Board Member Cobert and I went to Tallahassee for Florida School Board Association legislative days. We were able to visit every office of the Central Florida delegation, Orange County. We were able to speak to every representative, I believe, except for one. And again, to dovetail on what Mr. Rodriguez said, Eileen Fernandez and Cody Woody are working extremely hard up there to educate the legislators, represent us, follow the legislation, be able to tell us. It's incredible. I mean, I was exhausted after one afternoon, and they do this over and over again. So really, they are working very, very hard. As we know, HB 7055 passed the House. It goes to the Senate, and our hope is that the Senate will, at least they were doing it to some degree, will consider the 50 items individually rather than all together. I mean, there are 50 items in that one bill. We visited, again, every office, gave our plea why we didn't think that 7055 was procedurally the right way to present a bill, and outlined what we thought within the bill we thought could be changed, and really it didn't go too far. I mean, some of you have heard me say this before. I mean, we had one say wanted to get reelected, another one that said he didn't want to, he knew procedurally it was wrong, but there were other provisions in the bill that he wanted. We had another representative say, no matter what you do, it's going to pass. So there was a feeling of resignation up there, and it was hard not to be sort of feel the same way. There is a bill, though. There are several bills, but there's one particularly that we should be concerned about outside of 7055, and I don't have the number, but it's a bill that reduces the mandatory transportation busing from 2 miles to 1.5 miles without any funding that comes with it. So, 1088. Passed out of the committee. I mean, that's but we should be concerned about that. That's, you know, if it came with money, that'd be great. But it doesn't. And that could really eat into, what are we looking at? It could really eat into some of our funds. I mean, we're talking, where's our bus people? I mean, it could be millions. I think there's a bill, and I'm not sure where this one is yet, but one that would require us posting in God We Trust in all the schools. The performance pay bill is going nowhere. But as Representative Placencia said, he's a sponsor, he goes, you know, you introduce it 1 year, he'll bring it back next year. Linda Cobert spoke with Representative Cortez, and I'll let her give you that experience, but it was rather interesting and one that could help our displaced Puerto Rican students graduate with a diploma. Nice. With a diploma. Yeah, so it's stressful. It's stressful up there. Well, you know it. You had all of us coming to you, but it's that's why you don't go up there. But we did our best. We did our best. Ms. Colbert kept me calm. Ms. Colbert kept me calm. I know. Well, I do have to tell you why. You know, there's a bill up there, and it's asking for more financial accountability on the schools. We do that a lot, you know, but we offered, hey, look, instead of making auditing a managerial function, we want it to be insurance, you know, and I'm talking to the author of the bill, and, we'll send you that again. So I said, but I have to tell you, there's a line in here that says if a district is in financial crisis, that the board and the superintendent will forfeit their pay until the crisis is resolved. And I said, I just have to say, well, who's going to lead the ship? You know, you have to have a boss. Who's going to lead the ship? You know, they're not getting paid. And the response was, oh, well, the superintendent. They're obligated to do the job. And I mean, my mouth fell over, like, but you're not going to pay them. You know, how long does it take to right the ship on a failing, financially failing? You're not talking about 2 weeks. And they go, oh, no, they would get back pay. Does that sound realistic to you all?
So they want them to stay on the job?
They want them to stay on the job. They would forfeit it unless they're new to the position. So they amended it that way. Oh, I just think that's sort of out of touch, don't you? I mean, I just... So, Ms. Colbert kept me calm. Ms. Colbert kept me calm. You know, then once it... And then, you know, they look at you and they go, well, it's going to get passed anyway, so no matter what you do, I'm like, okay. Yes, I'm done.
So let me just say one thing, because people do watch these telecasts, that our finances are sound. We Absolutely. Are not in financial distress, and we don't expect our superintendent to ever be a threat of working for no pay. If anything, she's underpaid. Ms. Coburn.
Oh, that's nice. So Ms. Flynn is referring to a conversation. As she said, we visited, it was either 11 or 12 legislators in one day, and one of the things we were tasked with was the problem that we still don't have written direction from the Department of Education on how to award our students from Puerto Rico their diplomas. And time is ticking. And the stress that that's causing students and parents is inexcusable. So that was one of the things that Dr. Jara had tasked us with, is trying to get some resolution on that. So we went into Representative Cortez's office. We told him that this was a problem, and he picked up his cell phone and called the Commissioner of Education in Puerto Rico and said, we hear this is a problem, and you all are the holdup. They said, no, we're not the holdup. We'll give you whatever we want. He says, okay, I'm going to hold you to that, hung up the phone, and then called the Department of Education and the representative that is tasked with making this happen and said, I have Orange County in my office, and they're telling me that this is a holdup. Oh, no, he says it's Puerto Rico. He said, I just got off the phone with Puerto Rico. So you need to call the Commissioner of Education and get an answer, and I want an answer yesterday. And so that's the way you make things happen. And so I am telling Dr. Jara to let me know every single day whether or not we have that resolved, because I will call and email Representative Cortez every single day until we make that happen for those students.
I'm going to throw myself under the bus here. Hold their budget hostage, and you'll get results right away. This is a true story. When I was appropriations chair, I'd been promised over and over that a neighborhood in our community would get a privacy wall built around a newly expanded juvenile detention center, and was promised it and promised it and promised it for a month and a half. Finally, thanks to the cooperation of the speaker, we just zeroed out their budget and held it at zero for 2 weeks. And it's amazing that construction started before legislative adjourned. So it's one way to get their attention. I'm getting a little punch drunk up here. All right, what do we got next? Anything else? You go to the order?
I want to announce.
Okay, well, we got that. Let me ask this for 21 policy level issues, Dr. Mrs. Gordon.
Well, these issues at this time, because you've already voted it in, we will be dedicating more schools. I think we all of us have invitations. And Carver Middle School is just so beautiful. I had an opportunity to go and visit the Twin Sister School with Ms. Flynn at Timber Springs. I was going to say, it's just wonderful to see identical schools in the community, even though I do feel I have, I don't know. I'll take that back. They have great amenities there that we saw. You remember all the rooms? We went in and equipment. But it's equal I do want to say, since this is African American Month, I do visit the schools. I do want to see what's on the east, the west, the north, and the south. I do hope that people who wants to come and be in these positions that we're in realize how tough it is. Go ahead, interject. But we have fun with each other because we do visit and we adopt each other's school and. Yes, and it would, we would never go, Deborah would never let us leave out of this building without being posted. But we enjoyed the principal who had worked in both districts, but it was just so wonderful to see. Carver is such a beautiful school. Timber Springs is such a beautiful school. And if you have not seen these schools, taxpayers, you have got to go and visit and see what your tax dollars are doing, like Dr. Jenkins gave in her report. You're trying to get, and Chairman Sublett, we didn't have facilities. All of my schools were just in disrepair. And now every single school in my district, over 34 schools are brand new. And people in Winter Garden, they were here tonight, and they got up and told this board we had torn down all of our schools and kicked our kids out, and that we closed them, nothing. The only one that we did something with was Grand Avenue in the city of Orlando. They have that, and they're making it a recreation center. So I'm just excited. But I want to say this. Ms. Flynn knows that I go to Tallahassee, even though I take my personal days, and I go to Tallahassee, and I lobby. I was not able to go this time with them to walk the halls. I normally see Bishop Cabarrus is usually there in the chambers, and I normally go. And I also go, they don't get a chance to go all the time, but I go to Washington. I not only go to Tallahassee, but I go to Washington. Joey and Ms. Flynn, generally Pam, sometimes, you know, they go if they are available. It's hard to leave and go. So we'll be giving up our spring break. Cody, and I don't know if Eileen's coming. I think Scott. I think Dr. Jenkins and Daryl, you were scheduled. See, now she can't go. Like, I couldn't go because I had Rock Lake dedication. That's the only reason why I miss community going to Tallahassee to speak on your behalf. But I will be in Washington the week of spring break, walking the floors. Scott is supposed to. Scott Howard. Raise your hand back there. I hope you got my schedule because my main congresswoman is gone. Bless her heart. And y'all pray for my congresswoman because I love her. I didn't have to do any work when I got to Washington. She did it all for me. And I didn't go see just the Democrats. Everybody I saw were Republicans from Rubio all the way up to the top. She even got me in with the president one time. So, no, Dr. Jenkins did that. She got me in with the president. But I want to really thank you all for allowing us to serve. We are also celebrating Black History Month in February on Tuesday evening. And the Oak Ridge Chorus, if you can come, you definitely want to be here. The Oak Ridge, let me put it this way. I compete a lot with Jeff Redding. Dr. Jeff Redding, one of my former students with Pam, I compete with him because he's like my son and my child, and he's a grown man. But I love the West Orange, but we're not going to let the West Orange Winter Garden outdo us. We now have the Oak Ridge Community Choir. So if you want to see the debut of the Oak Ridge Community Choir, they will be performing here. The reception is at 5:30. And I believe we start the program at 6. And even if I'm still talking to everybody, we adjourn at 7:30. And then those who want to stay, we still have fun with you. But we normally get you out of here by 7:30. So the Rock Lake Oratorical Group, unbelievable. The Molly Ray Chorus, the Oak Hill Chorus, the Jones High Choir, the Oak Ridge Orchestra, and the Oak Ridge Community Choir will be performing for our honorees, and we honor those business partners that Dr. Jenkins have allowed her staff. And Scott Howard, I want to say hats off to you and Dylan and Shayla Hogan and Wendy and her staff and Deborah McGill and Nancy Knutler. This is amazing what they have done for me. And the both of the Susan Adams, Dr. Bridget Williams, and Susan Bonhill, for outstanding work that they have put together for Tuesday evening. So if you're not doing anything, just come and sit and relax and just bask and enjoy the children. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Ms. Flynn.
Thank you. I just wanted to warn the other board members, if you go and visit your schools with Miss Gordon, she kept telling the principal, "Oh, get Daryl to get that for you. Get Daryl." And I'd go behind her going, no. You know, so just be prepared.
And they told me, Mr.
Oh, you need that shade. Get Daryl to get it for you. But you're not getting a shade from me. Just so you got to watch out.
That is so true. I got to see that you get that stuff, Daryl.
So, board members, I've handed out the work session schedule. I would like you to take special note of something. Our annual facilities work session is coming up on March 29th. So please let Mr. Morris and the superintendent know if there are specific issues you want addressed. There's one I'm going to be bringing up, and some of you may have issues as well. So, get it to them ahead of time so they can be ready. Also, question for the board. We had a disproportionate amount of recognitions tonight. Try to limit it to two per meeting at most, but they all needed to be done. So my question is, do you want to have a recognition meeting? Because we have not had one since spring, Dr. Jenkins, or since last spring. So nod to the head, or it's up to you all. Do you want to do a recognition meeting? Okay, so we'll get Ms. McGill, if we can get rescheduled a recognition meeting, Dr. Jenkins, sometime before the end of the school year. All right. Anything else for the good of the order? Okay, we have our executive session. Sir, it's none of my business at all why you sat through the whole meeting, but God bless you. You have the most well-behaved young man there beside you. He deserves a medal for sitting through this meeting tonight. I feel that way about adults, much less a young boy like that. So you should be very proud. He's very well behaved, and you've been wonderful. Yeah. Wonderful. All right. With that, we are recessed, and we will reconvene upstairs.